As we continue to explore the quantum body and the universe beyond the quantum, and as you know, I'm totally captivated, obsessed, almost neurotic about exploring fundamental reality or infinity, as we call it. And as we continue our conversations, and as I explore this both intellectually and experientially and share this with you, I also keep getting emails from friends who are obsessed with the same thing. Who are we? What are we? What is existence? What is truth? What is reality? What's the meaning of life? What is the meaning of death? All those questions. So I have friends who are equally obsessed, and they send me periodically things they see in the news. So this morning, somebody, a friend of mine, sent me this thing from the Daily Mail Science. It says, "Are we living in a simulation? Scientist claims we're simply characters in an advanced virtual world," and says he has an easy way to prove it. He outlines the clues that suggest this world is not what it seems. He has also devised an experiment to test if we are living in a computer simulation. So this that's according to Melvin Wobson, an associate professor in physics at the University of Portsmouth. Our lives contain several clues that suggest we are merely characters in an advanced virtual world, etc., etc. The laws of physics that govern the universe are also akin to computer code. He says, while elementary particles that make up matter are like pixels. All this is very good, but you can see that these concepts are derived from that which can be perceived and conceived without ever addressing the imperceivable, inconceivable, from where the perceivable and the conceivable comes. So, you know, because spiritual traditions have always said that reality is boundless in the cosmos outward, and also reality is boundless in the atom inward, and that all boundaries are conceptual or perceptual, I decided to do some exploration on what the experts think. And as usual, I went to several AI chatbots and asked this question: are boundaries conceptual or perceptual? And is the universe truly boundless? So here's a summary of what I got. Whether all boundaries are conceptual or perceptual, and whether the universe is truly boundless, are complex questions with no definitive answers. Conceptual. Many boundaries we encounter are indeed conceptual, defined by our understanding and interpretation of the world. For example, national boundaries. Obviously, those are totally made up. Borders between colors in a spectrum. Again, colors are only in consciousness, not in the physical world. Or even the boundary between life and death are all conceptual constructs. Perceptual. Other boundaries are based on our perception of the world through our senses. The edge of a table, the horizon, or the sound of a voice are all boundaries we perceive through our senses, but may not exist objectively in the same way. Outward. Our current cosmological models suggest that the universe is finite but has no edge. Isn't that almost unimaginable? It's like the surface of a sphere where you can keep traveling without encountering an end, but the total surface area is still finite. This is due to the curvature of space-time caused by gravity. Inward. At the quantum level, things become even more intricate. The smallest particles don't have clearly defined boundaries in the same way as microscopic objects. Their position and existence are probabilistic, governed by wave functions. So whether the universe is boundless inward depends on how you define boundary in this context. What about dark energy and dark matter? Dark energy, well, it's true that dark energy is a mysterious force believed to be causing the expansion of the universe at an accelerating rate. This expansion could be interpreted as the creation of more space over time. However, it's important to note that dark energy doesn't necessarily create new space-time itself, but rather stretches the existing fabric of space-time. In conclusion, the nature of boundaries and the boundless nature of the universe are fascinating philosophical and scientific questions. While we have made progress in understanding these concepts, definitive answers remain elusive. As for dark energy, its role in space-time expansion is an active area of research, but it is important to avoid misinterpretations about its direct creation of space-time. I hope this helps. Actually, it doesn't. So then I went further and asked the question, can our imagination conceive or access reality beyond space-time? Here's what I got. Whether our imagination can conceive a reality beyond space and time is a complex philosophical question for which there's no easy answer. It ultimately depends on how you define and interpret the concepts of space-time and imagination. Limits of imagination. Our imagination is shaped by our experiences and our understanding of the world around us. These experiences are inherently limited to the space-time framework within which we exist. It can be difficult, if not impossible, to imagine something completely outside this framework. And then there's language, which is often used to express our imagination. It is also rooted in space and time. We use words like before, after, here, there, big, small, which all have meaning only within a spatial and temporal context. However, some philosophers argue that our imagination can, at least to some extent, transcend space and time. They point to concepts such as infinity, eternity, and timelessness, which seem to defy the usual limitations of our spatio-temporal framework. Of course, they do this through mathematics. Mystical and religious traditions often speak of realities beyond space and time, which may be accessed through altered states of consciousness or spiritual experience. While these experiences are subjective and difficult to verify, they suggest that our understanding of reality may be more limited than we typically assume. Even if we cannot conceive of a reality beyond space and time, this does not mean that such a reality cannot exist. Our limited understanding of the universe does not preclude the possibility of there being things beyond our current comprehension. The exploration of concepts beyond space and time can be a valuable exercise, even if it does not lead to definitive answers. It can help us to expand our understanding of reality and to challenge our assumptions about the nature of existence. I hope this information is helpful. Okay, to some extent. So let's actually forget all this science and philosophy. Just ask yourself, is the source of sound that which is soundless? Is the source of thought silence? Is the source of perception perceivable? Is the source of conception conceivable? Is the source of boundaries boundless? Is the source of the visible invisible? Is the source of that which appears as fragrance and odor odorless? Is the source of that which appears as flavor flavorless? Is the source of sensation without sensation? And then turn inward to that source, and what you encounter is I am. And I am cannot be conceived or perceived, but it can be felt. as the fundamental sense of being. That fundamental sense of being doesn't have any attributes, but is the source of everything that has an attribute. I am is inconceivable, imperishable, unimaginable, cannot be conceived, and yet is the felt sense of existence that pervades every experience in space-time. In fact, every experience is space-time. I am this, I am that, I am before, I am after, I am up, I am down, I am body, I am mind, I am brain, I am the universe. All of that comes from the imperishable I am. If we hold on to that sense of self, which is the only permanent sense that we actually have, everything else is in time. The source of time is timeless, and we are that. So I am is both nothing and everything, conceivable and perceivable, visible and invisible, nothing and everything, time bound and timeless. And I am is the only source of peace. The disturbance of I am is the universe. The undisturbed state is the peace beyond understanding. And this, by the way, that's a phrase in the Yoga Vaisheshta as well. The undisturbed state of consciousness is bliss. The disturbed state of consciousness is the appearance that we call body, mind, and universe. So I am is pure joy, pure peace, pure knowingness, pure existence, pure evolution, pure self-regulation, pure homeostasis, and pure immortality. Hold on to the feeling I am. Even the thought is not necessary, just the feeling of existence that never goes away in waking, dreaming, or sleeping. That which never goes away, like the screen on which this program is appearing, is always there, metaphorically speaking. The programs come and go. I know I've said this many ways before, but I just enjoy sharing it.